Well, Jesus and his followers were gathered one day, and they were sitting in a circle. And one of his followers said to Jesus, "Master, what is the kingdom of heaven like?" And Jesus said, "Let me tell you a story. One day, once upon a time, there was this poor woman. And she lived with her family in this small village, and they grew a lot of their food, but they weren't able to grow everything. So sometimes she had to travel by foot to a nearby village to trade the food that they had for other food. And so she would take this walk and go to this village, and it was, you can imagine, it was hot and dusty, and the trail was rough. And she would come to this village, and she would come bringing bunches of food to trade. And she brought with her a vase to carry grain home in, or meal, as they called it, which really was coarse flour. And so she traded her goods for flour, which was poured into her vase, and it wasn't, you know, she was a poor woman, so it wasn't a really well-designed vase. It wasn't made out of metal. But anyway, it's what she had. And so it was filled with meal, and then she tied it to her back. And then she made the trek back home, which is hard and dusty and long and hot. And as she's walking, she didn't realize it, but some of the rope loosened, and one of the handles broke off of the jar. And the jar tipped over, and it began to leak out, or the grain seeped out of it. And when she got home, and she took off the jar, and she set it down, and she looked inside, she saw it was empty. And Jesus said, "This is what the kingdom of heaven is like." So today, I based this talk on Greg Braden's book, Wisdom Codes, Ancient Words to Rewire Our Brains and Heal Our Hearts. And this book is really about neuroscience, right? And it's about spirituality. And it's about how can we connect our mind and our heart. Our hearts, as many of us know, have about 40,000 cells that are similar to the cells in our brains. So the idea is that when we can have that coherence between our thoughts, our brain, and our heart, we can act more fully and be more present to life because we're blending the intellect and the heart. And that becomes how we approach our life. It allows us to be more present and more powerful and really be able to access this powerful energy of spirit that's within ourselves. So this parable of the woman in the jar, anybody heard of it before? It comes from verse 97 in the Gospel of Thomas. And the Gospel of Thomas is kind of a unique book. It's not a typical book of stories like many books in the Bible are. It's actually believed to be things that Jesus said, and this parable is one of the things that he said, and truth that he said. And many people believe it's probably the most accurate idea that we have of what Jesus really taught. And, this Gospel of Thomas was discovered in 1945, and it's part of the some manuscripts from the Hammadi Library in Egypt. So I love this book because it feels so relevant, and the truth is so like raw. And I believe that the purpose of this parable is to help us discover what precious parts of ourselves we have let go of. Like the meal, the grain in this woman's jug, that drains out without her knowing it. What are the things within ourselves that we let go of? Some of those common substances might be our ability to love, might be our ability to really feel deeply, to be optimistic, to be totally present in this moment, and to be able to love people that we disagree with, or to forgive people that we perceive have hurt us in some way. So I wonder, what has been leaking from your jar? Can you get any idea of things that you have kind of let go of to not be present, to not be able to fully love, to not be able to forgive somebody that hurt you, to not be able to forgive yourself? Jesus says, the kingdom of heaven is like this vase. The kingdom of heaven is like this empty vase, because it's that place where we decide to discover what it is that we have let go of, and in a sense given away, that keeps us from being our spiritual self, from being present, to being the essence of love. So when we're in that place, we get to look at, okay, what is it that I've given away? So we'll take this wonderful parable line by line and look at what it means metaphysically and what it means spiritually. The first line is, the kingdom of the Father is like a certain woman who is carrying a jar full of meal. And we are all born being full, being perfect, being the essence of love. And we can be like that woman carrying that full love. That is our potential. That's what we're born with. And then the second verse says, while she was walking on the road, still some distance from home, the handle of the jar broke off, and the meal emptying out behind her on the road. You know, our nature is to be loving and compassionate, to be joyful, to be present, to be forgiving. And sometimes the things happen in our lives that just doggone pee us off. Ever happened to you? I mean, normally I'd say piss, but it is a week before Christmas. But so I'm trying to, you know, monitor what I say a little bit.
A little bit,
yeah. Emphasis on the little bit. But, you know, things happen in our lives that you ever have somebody that makes you mad and you say, doggone it, I'm never going to love that person again. I'm never going to forgive that person. Doggone it, I'm going to stand in my truth. Right? It's a false truth. Anything that takes us away from love isn't the truth of who we are. It isn't the power that we have. Our nature is to love. So the line three says, she did not realize it. She had noticed no incident. And sometimes things happen in our lives and we don't even notice it. The first time we might say, well, you know what, I'm cutting this person off, or I'm cutting this ability of myself to really be present because maybe somebody criticized me or somebody hurt me, or God's sakes, I certainly can't forgive myself, right? Because how would I learn from my past if I ever forgave myself? What an illusion that is. We're living a lie if that's the case, if we don't forgive ourselves for what we did. And so, you know, sometimes we don't even notice what has happened, even though we gave it away. You know, we often give in or compromise ourselves to situations in our life, and we give up our power. Because perhaps somebody that has more power than us seems to be the right one or seems to know what's true. And I know for myself, sometimes I silence myself or don't speak up for what I believe, because that's just a pattern I grew up with in my life. Not to be willing to stand in my truth. And the fourth line says, when she reached her house, she set the jar down and found it was empty. Ever get to that place where you're like, I know I can do better than this. I know that I can love. I know that I can be present. I know that I should forgive. But I look into the jar, and my jar of resources, my essence, my power is gone because I let it slip away. We can sometimes lose ourselves over time. Oh, take a breath. Because there is good news. It's not all so dismal. The truth is, and this is the good news, is that the parts of ourselves that appear to be absent, the love that seems to have disappeared, and the love that seems to have disappeared, are never gone. It's still there. We've simply put it someplace else for a short time. And we have the ability to bring it back. But oftentimes it takes that awareness. Like anything on the spiritual path, we have to realize that, oh my gosh, something's missing. I've given up that my potential for power, and I want to get it back. And the good news is that in further scriptures from the Gospel of Thomas, Jesus goes into how we can get this back. And, you know, it's just like, you know, I believe that our soul can never be destroyed. You know, the love that we are, I think our soul is our love, it's our essence, it's that the truth of spirit that's within us can never be destroyed. It's right here. It's powerful. It goes with us always. So the key to healing our vessel is found in the parables that follow the parable of the woman in the jar. And let's look at verse number 106 from the Gospel of Thomas. Jesus said, when you make the two one, you will become the sons of man. And when you say, mountain, move away, it will move away. This scripture, in my mind, has been really misunderstood or misinterpreted. I believe that what the scripture is saying, when the two become one, what do you think that means? When the two become one, what does that mean? It's our heart and our mind, and it's also our heart and our mind and our spirit, right? When we become connected to the essence and the presence of truth, to the presence of God, to the presence of love, to the presence of understanding, one thing that we can never lose, that which we can't seem to find in a moment, but when we become one with that presence, and when we realize that everything that happens just happens. You ever notice? Sometimes stuff happens, right? And we can either get really pissed off. I already used that word, so I can use it again. We can really get upset about it, or and really be judgmental and really fight it and be like, I'm going to get back at those guys, right? Or I'm going to get back at myself. Or we can just say, it is what it is. It just happened. I'm becoming one with the presence, and just to realize, you know, even in this difficult situation, I can find my peace. I can find my love. I can forgive. I can be the essence. I can be one with the presence of God that's everywhere in the universe that Jesus talked about so much that's been misunderstood. You know, when we become one with Spirit, we stop judging. Just let it be. Stop judging ourselves as bad. Stop judging others as bad. And just be present to what is. Now, a large part of it that our ego often does is to think that we are victims, right? I'm just a victim. The world did this to me. My parents did this to me. My siblings did this to me. My spouse did this to me. My friend did this to me. My enemy did this to me. And when we can get out of that victim consciousness and open our hearts, you know, it's an illusion that we have that when we believe that we can hurt somebody by not forgiving them, the only person it hurts is ourselves. We give our power away. We step out of that power. You know, in the scripture, when Jesus talks about moving the mountain, he's not physically talking about moving a mountain, but he's talking about embracing a truth that is so powerful that it seems as if it could move a mountain. Because it moves a mountain of illusion, a mountain of hate. And we are able to stand in our power. This parable is a lot about changing our perspective, changing the way we see our life, changing the way we see the situations in our life, and responding out of a place of love. In other words, we're realizing that the grain, the meal, the flour can never really seep out of our jar. And Jesus is saying the kingdom of heaven is that place when we realize that we have the power, that we are vessels of love. Our human body, our human spirit is often referred to as a vessel. And we are vessels of love. So why do we let our essence, let our nourishment, and our precious gifts go? I think it comes down to one word. We think it's survival. We often take on these ideas, and you know, our ego is all about surviving. It's all about making others wrong, making us right, and doing whatever it can to keep us alive. And that's a good thing. It serves a good, it's a good responsibility that it has to keep us alive. But oftentimes we become defensive. We let our grain, our meal, our essence out because we think it's going to help us survive. But the truth of it is, when we do that, we're giving our power away. We're giving the essence of who we are, the love and the light and the truth and just the strength. So how do we recognize the parts of us that are missing? We see them in somebody else. We see them when we meet another person or we see another person and you go, have you ever said, wow, I want some of that, right? I want some of their love or some of their compassion or some of their ability to be present or some of the way that they play an instrument, right? And we see these things in someone else and part of us goes, wow. You know, sometimes we're even attracted to someone who has the gifts that we don't have because we want them. We want to be near somebody who has those gifts. This is what happens when we are mysteriously attracted to someone. So the idea is to pay attention and to realize, wow, isn't it interesting? I'm finding myself attracted to this person. And what is that all about? There's a part of me that recognizes myself. We often observe what we are missing in other people. Ever notice that? So, how can we use this parable? So, I would suggest read the parable, And in my walk your talk, which is on the table by the door, I have the words to this parable, and I just invite you just to read it and to contemplate on it and see how it relates to your life. So I will ask you a couple questions about that. Maybe this will help you to have some clarity. So the first question is, do I see a parallel between the woman carrying the jar of meal and my life? Is there some place in your life where you have at some place, maybe unconsciously, made the decision to give something away? You know, and maybe it is to not embrace the truth of who you are. Because you know that you are a powerful person, present, expression of God. But sometimes we choose to compromise that because it's too much work or it's too difficult or somebody told us at one point in our life that we can't do something. So what is it that you've given away? And the second question is, do I feel empty and unable to be present, to love, to have compassion, to feel joy, to forgive? And just breathe into that. And you may get a sense of some of it today, and perhaps as you reflect on this parable, to get an idea, you know, to spiritually progress in our lives, sometimes we have to look at the stuff that doesn't seem like it's so pretty. But it is when we look at the meal that we've lost, we can discover the truth of who we are. And the third question is there someone in my life that has the qualities that I desire? Is there someone, you know, it could be in your life, or it could even be someone on TV, or someone, you know, that you know of. Is there someone that expresses some of the qualities that part of you goes, oh, I want some of that? Because if that happens, the truth is you're recognizing yourself. You're recognizing who you are. You're recognizing some of the essence of and the beauty that you are blessed with in your life. Sometimes that answer comes almost immediately. And I think this is such an amazing truth. Because what I found, even in working on this talk in the last week, is that it's like peeling an onion, right? And the more I look, the more I discover. The more parts of myself I realize I've let go. The more parts of myself that I realize who I am and what I am as a spiritual being having a physical experience. Remember, what you were drawn to is part of you that's just been asleep. Now, what a beautiful time of year, being it's Christmas, and in unity we celebrate the birth of that Christ within us, right? That true essence of who we are. That's what this unity movement is all about, and we especially celebrate it now. What a great opportunity for discovery this is, this week before Christmas or days before Christmas. So I invite you to close your eyes and take a deep breath. Breathing in and breathing out. Just allow yourself to relax. to be present right now, to know that this is a safe place. And I wonder, as you reflect on the mind, thoughts, can you bring your thoughts into your heart? I like to think that wisdom, true wisdom, is a blending of the mind, of the thoughts, and the heart. It's a wisdom that taps into both the thinking and the logic and into the heart, the place of love, peace, truth. And in this place, we're able to be present with our mind, with our heart, to be able to love and to think at the same time. So, what is it that occurs to you this morning? Is there some part of you that can relate to the woman in the jar? To being that vessel that has temporarily misplaced a part of who you are? Imagine that you can pick up all that grain, all that meal, and you can place it back into your vessel, into your jar, into the essence that you are. How does that feel? Let's just sit for a moment or two. Being with blend of mind and heart, holding our true essence and resting in love and peace for a few moments in the silence. My heart and mind act in harmony and I reveal the splendor of my authentic self in everything I think, say, and do. And I invite you to bring your awareness back into this moment. And let's whisper these words together. Let's say them together. My heart and mind act in harmony, and I reveal the splendor of my authentic self in everything I think, say, and do. Oh, so at this time, I invite you to prepare your love offerings and to thank you for being here today and sharing with us. Even those of you. Boy, I felt like I was at the Mormon Tabernacle there for a second. You know, you don't even need all those organs and horns when you have Kurt Lee with you, you know? So, as you contemplate your gifts for Unity on Maui, I invite you to consider what it feels like to be in the Christmas spirit, to be a giver, to open your heart and your mind to sharing what is yours with us so that it is ours. I know that and believe that as we share our gifts with Unity on Maui, we hope to continue this work and its positive influence on our lives. Sometimes I think that when we give, we open ourselves up to receiving. You know, the universe kind of operates in a give and take way. So as we show to the universe that we are a giver, we also open ourselves up to receive. So, and if you're looking to give to Unity on Maui, there's a few ways you can do it. You can go to our website, www.unityonmaui.org, and click on the donate button and donate there. And you can also send a check in the mail the old-fashioned way to Unity on Maui, 483 South High Street in Wailuku. And thank you for your gift. And so as we hold our gifts, those of us that are here today, why don't we affirm and pray together our affirmation of prosperity, which begins, through a grateful, giving heart, my mind and life overflow with the abundance of God's all-providing infinite supply. And so it is. Oh, thank you, loving spirit, for these gifts that have come to us in love. We hold them, we embrace them, we give thanks for them, knowing that they move through this ministry out into the world, and we behold a world filled with light, with love, and with peace. And so it is. Thank you. So, today's flowers are offered by the infamous Al Cantorna. He was here earlier today. He ran in, dropped the flowers on. But we'll let him know later on that we really celebrated him. He's probably watching, and he's couch churching today, I'm sure, with Virgie. I guess, or you could church couch, I guess, can you, if you wanted to? I don't know. So anyway, thanks, Al. Thanks, Virgie. He dedicated these flowers to Virgie's birthday. So happy birthday, Virgie. We love you, and our thoughts and prayers are with you both. And if you would like to have us celebrate you and an occasion in your life on Sunday morning, there's a sign-up sheet on the table at the back, and you can sign up and to bring flowers on any certain Sunday, and let us know also what the occasion might be, and we'd be happy to celebrate you and whatever it is you'd like for us to celebrate with you. So next week, my talk is titled, Don't Throw It Away. And, you know, what I've noticed, we are often can get so excited about the new year, right? Can't wait for 2022. And sometimes we forget to celebrate the things that happened in 2021, the things that offered us spiritual growth, the things that offered us peace, the things that were challenging that we got through, things that were challenging that we learned from. So next week, we're going to look at, you know, how can we be with 2021 so that we release it in a healthy way that serves us and serves our lives. So that'll be fun. Be right here, same time, same station, next week at 10 o'clock. And also, Christmas Eve is coming up. Can't believe it. It's just 4 days away. Or it's Friday, right? It's Friday? Okay, 5 days away. And, you know, as you know, we've had 25 seats available in each of the two services at 4 and 6. And as of right now, we only have one seat available for the 6 p.m. service. And our technical team has worked diligently to try and put a screen outside so we can have some additional people come outside and sit and watch our service from outside. But unfortunately, even putting our minds together just before the service started today, we could not make that happen. So the seats that are available are the seats that will be available on Christmas Eve. And if you haven't signed up, you can watch us live at 6 o'clock on Facebook in the comfort of your home, as so many people are doing right now. And take pictures of yourself, by the way, and send them in. And I'd love to show them on Sunday morning of how you are dressed for church. And, you know, because we're on Maui, it's probably not a whole lot different than how we come to church, right? So that'll be fun. And then the next Friday is our Burning Bowl service, and that'll be happening right here as well. And tickets are offered again today after the service for 25 people. That'll be a lot of fun. It's really a great time to release the old and embrace the new. And that'll be happening also 6 p.m. on New Year's Eve night. So you can come and get rid of the old, burn them up, and then go out and make some more on New Year's Eve for the following year. But it'll be a lot of fun. It's always a really powerful service. And you can interpret that however you like. You know, I'm just... Oh, okay. Stop there. Should I stop there, Kurt? All right. So that'll be fun. And we are looking to get our technology up to speed and to offer a place to sit outside for people. But that won't happen till after the first of the year. So thank you for holding us in prayer for that. And we are so blessed. And if you like today's talk, if you're watching out in Facebook land, you can look at the Walk Your Talk, which is in our newsletter, which is a summary of what I shared today. And for those of us here, that's available on the table in the back. If you wonder tomorrow, that guy yacked and yacked and yacked, and what did he say? Something about Thomas? Anyway, so that's back there for you. So I think before I get myself in more trouble, we should probably end this show. So I invite you to stand up. Thank you for being here this morning. Let's know and firm and pray. Let's pray together, huh? Prayer for protection, huh? Okay, let's do it like this. Together. The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us, and the presence of God watches over us wherever we are. God is. God bless you, friend. Thank you for being here. Mahalo, and Merry Christmas, and Aloha.